Good morning. Today we're going to review conductors in electrostatic equilibrium for AP Physics C, electricity and magnetism.
Flippin' physics!
Conductors are materials where the electrons are free to move rather easily. However, when they are in electrostatic equilibrium, that means that the charges in the object are stationary.
I thought equilibrium meant the net force acting on the object or system was zero. That means the acceleration is zero, which means it could be at rest or moving at a constant velocity, right? So that means the charges do not have to be stationary. They could be moving at a constant velocity.
Electrostatics is the study of electromagnetic phenomena that occur when there are no moving charges. So by definition, the charges in conductors in electrostatic equilibrium need to be stationary.
Right.
There are four things I need you to remember about conductors in electrostatic equilibrium. The first is that the electric field inside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium equals zero. Billy, what would happen if the electric field inside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium were not equal to zero?
If there were an electric field inside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium, then the charges on the conductor would experience an electrostatic force equal to the charge times the electric field. The charges would experience an acceleration, and the conductor would not be in electrostatic equilibrium. Therefore, there must be zero electric field inside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium.
Well done, Billy. Notice that this means that anything inside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium is shielded from all external electric fields. This is called electrostatic shielding and can be quite useful. The second thing you need to remember about conductors in electrostatic equilibrium is that all excess charges are located on a surface of the conductor. To prove this, let's do an example with a solid conducting sphere. Let's draw a Gaussian surface in the shape of a sphere which is concentric with the solid spherical conductor, but with a radius that is a little bit smaller than the radius of the solid spherical conductor. I've exaggerated the difference in spherical radii in the illustration so you can actually see the Gaussian sphere. However, remember the Gaussian sphere is only a tiny bit smaller than the solid conducting sphere. Bobby, please use Gauss's law to prove the excess charges in the solid conducting sphere are concentrated on the surface of the solid conducting sphere.
Okay, Gauss's law states that the electric flux through a closed surface equals the closed surface integral of the dot product of the electric field through the closed surface and the infinitesimal area vector dA. And it equals the charge enclosed in the Gaussian surface divided by the permittivity of free space. But we already know the electric field inside the Gaussian sphere equals zero. You just showed that, which means the electric flux through the Gaussian sphere equals zero, which means the charge enclosed in the Gaussian sphere equals zero. Therefore, all the excess charges must be outside the Gaussian sphere, and therefore all the excess charges must be on the surface of the conductor.
Thank you, Bobby. The third thing you need to remember about conductors in electrostatic equilibrium is that the electric field, which is just outside the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium, is perpendicular to the surface and equals the local surface charge density divided by the permittivity of free space. Local surface charge density means the surface charge density of the conductor in electrostatic equilibrium right near the location of the electric field. Let's start with the direction of the electric field at the surface of the conductor in electrostatic equilibrium. It is always perpendicular to the surface. If the electric field has a component parallel to the surface of the conductor, the charges would have an electrostatic force acting on them parallel to the surface, which would cause the charges to accelerate, and the conductor would no longer be in electrostatic equilibrium. Therefore, the electric field at the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium must be perpendicular to the surface. Also, because equipotential surfaces are always perpendicular to the electric field, the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium must be an equipotential surface.
You could also determine the electric potential difference between two points A and B, for example, on the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium. That equals the negative of the integral from point A to point B of the dot product of the electric field and the infinitesimal linear displacement dr. Or we could use the non-dot product version of the integral with cosine theta instead. You just showed that the electric field is always at a right angle to the surface, which means the angle between the electric field and the direction of dr along the surface of the conductor in electrostatic equilibrium always equals 90 degrees. And the cosine of 90 degrees equals zero, so the electric potential difference between any two points on the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium equals zero, which is the definition of an equipotential surface. Right, Mr. P?
Exactly, Billy. Thanks. In order to determine the magnitude of the electric field just outside the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium, we need to zoom in quite a bit on the surface and draw an infinitesimally small Gaussian cylinder with its cylindrical axis normal to the surface of the conductor. Bo, please use Gauss's law to determine the electric field.
Sure. Gauss's law says electric flux through a closed surface equals the closed surface integral of the dot product of the electric field through the closed surface and the area vector dA. We did something kind of like this when we figured out the electric field around an infinitely large thin plate of charges. The total electric flux equals the electric flux through the side of the Gaussian cylinder plus the electric flux through the left end plus the electric flux through the right end. The angle between the area vector dA from the side of the Gaussian cylinder and the electric field is always 90 degrees. The angle between the area vector dA from the left end of the Gaussian cylinder and the electric field is always 0 degrees. They are in the same direction. And the angle between the area vector dA from the right end of the Gaussian cylinder and actually the electric field inside a conductor is in electrostatic equilibrium always equals 0. So there is 0 electric flux through the right end of the Gaussian cylinder. The electric field is uniform over the left end of the Gaussian cylinder, which means we can take electric field out from the integral.
Actually, because the Gaussian cylinder is infinitesimally small, even if the electric field is not uniform, we can still take it out from the integral because it would be uniform over the infinitesimally small area dA. Right, Mr. P?
That is correct, Billy. Thanks. Bo, please keep going.
Sure. The integral of dA for just the left end is just the area of one end of the Gaussian cylinder. We know surface charge density equals charge over area, which means for this Gaussian cylinder, the local surface charge density equals the charge inside the Gaussian cylinder over the area of one end of the Gaussian cylinder. That means the charge inside the Gaussian cylinder equals local surface charge density times the area of one end. We can substitute that in for the charge inside the Gaussian cylinder, and
everybody brought the area of the end of the Gaussian cylinder to the party.
Everybody brought mass. And the electric field just outside a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium equals the surface charge density right at that location over permittivity of free space.
Thank you, Bo. Well done. The last of the four things you need to remember about conductors in electrostatic equilibrium is that for an irregular shape, the local surface charge density is at its maximum where the radius of curvature is at its minimum. In other words, the largest number of excess charges per area will be where the radius of curvature is the smallest. To prove this, we have two conducting spheres connected by a long conducting wire with the whole system in electrostatic equilibrium. This system is a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium. In other words, when two conductors are brought into contact with one another, the charges redistribute such that both conductors are at the same electric potential. Please realize this happens so quickly that the time for this to occur is considered to be negligible.
Oh, right. Both conductors have the same electric potential because all the charges are on the surfaces of the conductors in electrostatic equilibrium, and the surfaces of conductors in electrostatic equilibrium are equipotential surfaces. So when two charged conductors touch one another, The excess charges redistribute themselves to make it so both conductors are at the same electric potential.
Exactly, Billy. For our example, the radius of sphere 2 is smaller than the radius of sphere 1, and the distance d between the two spheres is much, much larger than either radius. Because this is a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium, the electric potential on the surface of each sphere has the same value, of the Coulomb constant times charge all over the radius of each sphere.
Everybody brought the Coulomb constant to the party.
Everybody brought mass.
Sure. We can then rearrange the equation to get the charge on sphere 1 equals the ratio of the radii of the two spheres, 1 over 2, times the charge on sphere 2. Because radius 2 is less than radius 1, radius 1 divided by radius 2 is greater than 1. That means the excess charge on sphere 1 is greater than the excess charge on sphere 2. The magnitude of the electric field at the surface of each sphere equals the Coulomb constant times charge divided by the square of the radius of the sphere. We can use those equations to get the ratio of the electric fields at the surface of each sphere, 1 over 2. We can simplify that equation by multiplying by the multiplicative inverse of the denominator. The Coulomb constant cancels out on the top and bottom. For charge 1, we can substitute in radius 1 over radius 2 times charge 2. And now, a lot of variables cancel out. Charge 2 cancels out, one of the radii for sphere 2 cancels out, and one of the radii for sphere 1 cancels out. And all we are left with is radius 2 over radius 1. That means electric field 2 equals radius 1 over radius 2 times electric field 1. And again, because radius 2 is smaller than radius 1, radius 1 over radius 2 is greater than 1. That means the electric field at the surface of sphere 2 is more than the electric field at the surface of sphere 1. And because we previously showed that the electric field at the surface of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium equals the local surface charge density over permittivity of free space, that means the surface charge density of sphere 2 is more than the surface charge density of sphere 1. We have just shown that where the radius of curvature of a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium is smaller, there is a larger surface charge density. In other words, where the local surface charge density is at a maximum, the radius of curvature of the conductor in electrostatic equilibrium is at a minimum. That concludes my review of conductors in electrostatic equilibrium for AP Physics C, Electricity and Magnetism. Next time, we are going to review capacitors. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.